first lesson comes from Isaiah chapter 63, reading the second half of verse 16, verse 17, and then the first 8 verses of chapter 64. These words will serve as a basis of this morning's sermon. We hear it. O Lord, you are our Father, our Redeemer from of old is your name. Why, O Lord, do you make us wander from your ways and harden our hearts so we do not revere you? Return for the sake of your servants, the tribes that are of your inheritance. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains would tremble before you, as when fire sets twigs ablaze and causes water to boil. Come down and make your name known to your enemies and cause the nations to quake before you. For when you did awesome things that we did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you. Since ancient times, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. You come to the help of those who gladly do right, who remember your ways. But when we continue to sin against them, you are angry. How then can we be saved? All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. No one calls on your name or strives to lay hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and made us waste away because of our sins. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, you are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. This is the word of our Lord. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The portion of God's word to focus on this morning was that first reading from Isaiah. But as we begin meditation on those words, let's pray. Lord, as we prepare again to celebrate the fact that you have already come into this world to be our Redeemer, help us also to look forward to your second coming and mold us into the way you would want us to be. In your name we pray. Amen. Your brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, it's a little cliche if I just kind of run through newspaper headlines for a bit, but you know why we do it. We kind of go through these various things that are happening because it just feels like everything is just kind of in a state of disarray. It's just kind of bad. Anything that you hear from all the political unrest and turmoil that come in response to President Obama's executive order regarding the deportation of illegal immigrants, to the violent riotings happening in Ferguson when Officer Wilson was not indicted by the grand jury, to just the fact that Ebola is the new disease that is ravaging our world and killing people, and we're afraid. And we look at the problems that are going on in our world. We look at these bad things, and we just kind of want someone to fix it. I mean, we always want that. Somebody come down and fix it. And if you have turned to prayer asking God to come down and do that, you're in good company. You're not alone. That's what Isaiah is doing here in his prophecy. He sees what is happening in the world around him. He sees what's happening to the Israelites. That here they are, that after bad king, all of a sudden God's people are going astray. And he knows that this is going to mean soon and imminent judgment. And he is asking God to come down and fix this. Because as it stands right now, you've just handed your people over to unbelief. And that's what God does. When people don't want to follow him and don't want to believe in him and don't want to follow his ways, he lets them. And so Isaiah laments, why, O Lord, do you make us wander from your ways and harden our hearts so that we do not revere you? Isaiah's saying something's got to change. We have to be changed. Because right now, this is no good. So what more can a believer ask for than what Isaiah says? Return for the sake of your servants, the tribes that are your inheritance. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down. Come down and make your name known to your enemies and cause the nations to quake before you. Isaiah is asking God, come down with your fiery justice. Let's fix this world. Let's make it into something God-pleasing. Let's change it. Let's reshape it and mold it into a God-pleasing way. even as Isaiah is praying that, he realizes that he is not exempt from that reform. He makes the next statement. But when we continued to sin against them, your ways, you, God, were angry. How then can we be saved? Isaiah doesn't turn this into an us and them battle. Like, God, look at all these good believers out there, and I'm one of them. We don't deserve your wrath and punishment, so just fix all the other people of this world. No, he realizes, I'm a part of the problem. I continue to sin against your way. You have to also reform me. You have to fix me. So I know when I'm asking you to come, to rend those heavens, and to come on down, to return with your justice, I know that's going to affect me too. When that time comes, when Emmanuel comes, we already know that day has come once, but we know when he comes again, he will bring peace, he will bring order, he will right every wrong. Peace and justice will be across the entire world. And that is what we want. And we rightfully pray for that with Isaiah. But at the same time, when we ask for God to come down and bring his justice, we are asking that he does that to us as well. Not just change this world around us, but change me. Reshape me, mold me into something new and to something different. Because when I look into my heart, I have to agree that I'm in the same place as Isaiah. I mean, when you heard that litany of things, of how bad it is, how bad people are, can you insert yourself into those statements? Think about this from the first person perspective, verses 5 through 7. But when I continue to sin against your ways, you are angry. How can I be saved? I have become like one who is unclean. All my righteous acts are like filthy rags. I shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, my sins sweep me away. I don't call on your name or strive to lay hold of you, for you have hidden your face from me and made me waste away because of my sins. Hear those words, and maybe you think the same thing I think when I read those the first time. That's not me. I'm not that unrighteous. I'm not that one who you hate, who you need to change and reform. I don't sin like the rest of them. I'm one of the good guys. I'm a believer. I'm faithful. You love me. You forgave me. You don't really feel this way about me. It's like a hyperbole, an exaggeration of my sin. What if it's not? What if what Isaiah said here is truly you and is truly me? What if we really are that sinful? What if we really are the ones who continue to sin against the way of the Lord, and so we deserve to shrivel up like a leaf, one of those dead leaves that you see lying around now, and just blown away by the wind? The truth of the matter is, God is angry with us when we sin against him. We can't escape that. And although it is true, God does love you, but there is a warning here. If we are one of these who continues to sin against the Lord, who continues in that path, all that remains for us is judgment in the end. We face those temptations each and every day. Our temptations, your temptations versus my temptations, they may be different temptations, but you know what? It's the same process. The same things that try to drag you away from the path of the Lord. The same things that come to you, those vices that you know you have a hard time resisting, you know that are a particular weakness of yours. And you have that constant battle, and if we just lay over and die, if we just give up that fight against temptation and we continue to sin against the Lord, we are shaping our lives for nothing more than destruction. We're reshaping our path to eternal life into a path that leads straight to hell.
because all my righteous acts are like filthy rags, that when I sin against him, he is angry with me. So I need to be reshaped. I need to be molded to be different. I need to be better than what I am. Isaiah saw that too. He saw that not only in the people he was preaching to, he saw it in himself. He needed to be changed. But he made a realization that even though I am the way that I am, you, God, are still my Father. You are still the one who created me, who molded me so specifically. You're the one who made a covenant, a pact with me, saying that you are going to take away my sins. You're going to be there for me. You're my redeemer from of old, the one who buys me back from the grave. That those covenants that you made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one that you said the offspring would come from you, the one who would bless all nations, you're still going to keep that promise, God. Because you're still our Father. You're still our redeemer from of old. So that is why Isaiah prays so boldly for God, asking for him to return. He knows it means change. He knows it means he needs to be reformed and he needs to be reshaped. And Isaiah is ready for it. As he says, "We are the clay. You are the potter. We are all the work of your hand." So Isaiah is saying to God, "If you're going to reshape this world, reshape me. Change me. Because I know I sin. I know I fall into temptation. I know I'm not enough. So reshape me. Make me something new. Make me your work so that I am pleasing in your sight." That's why we boldly pray the same thing. We realize we are in the same boat. We're just as sinful. We need to be changed. And so we say, "God, yes, I know I sin against you. Yes, I know I deserve your wrath and punishment. I know that is what I deserve. And I know my righteous acts are like filthy rags. But you are my Father. Reshape me. Mold me into something new. Be that redeemer from of old that you said you are, the one who buys me back from death, from the grave, from Satan himself. Mold me into something new, that when temptation comes my way, mold my hands together in prayer, that I ask for your help and for your strength. Shape a new path in my life, one that leads away from temptation, one that leads entirely towards you. Shape a new schedule in my life that makes you as a priority. Change me and reshape me by the forgiveness you give me." Because we are the clay. I'm putty in your hands. So reshape me, God, according to your will, that I do your work, that in forgiveness and repentance, I am ready for that day when you do return, knowing that you will usher me into heaven. Amen. In the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with you always. Amen.